Anyway, let's get rocking and rolling. If y'all notice on the front of the worship guide, and y'all probably don't, but on the front of the worship guide and on that, we changed the graphic because the first 6 weeks have been kind of dreary. Like, let's make it through suffering. Let's learn about what God is doing in the midst of suffering, the purpose, the limitations to suffering, the fact that God is always working out some plan in our lives in that season and that trial, and it's preparing us for eternity. But this week, it's all about the good stuff. It's all about heaven. Because if you only look at the negative side of suffering and all that you go through and do not compare it to the eternal weight of glory that is awaiting us as believers, you've missed one side of the coin of the equation when you talk about suffering. I would have misled all of you if I only spoke about what you're going through without telling you about where you're going. Amen? I would mislead you and I would misguide you because Paul says this in Romans 8:18. He says, For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us. I mean, do you see where he's going with that? He is a man who has been through more trials and more persecution and more afflictions and more pain and more mental anguish than I would imagine any of us in here in our lifetimes will go through. And yet he is able to say to the believers in Rome, it's not even worth comparing. It's not even worth comparing what we're going through now with what is awaiting us because it's too great and too glorious to even begin to describe. And so when we get in the book of Revelation, if y'all would hold two places with me this morning, Revelation chapter 21, verse 1, Revelation 21, verse 1, and also 1 Corinthians, second place told, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 35. We're going to go to those two sections of verses, but if you notice John in the book of Revelation, he is using a lot of terms like or as. It's a lot of metaphors. The book of Revelation is a ton of symbolism. There's obviously literal elements in there, but it is all a lot of symbolism. Going back to the Old Testament, there are well over 500 different allusions, not direct quotations, but allusions in the book of Revelation alone to the Old Testament. Primarily, the book of Isaiah and the Psalms is where John is pulling so much of his material from. C.S. Lewis said this, a book, or in this case, a sermon series on suffering, which says nothing about heaven, is leaving out almost the whole of the one side of the account. Scripture and tradition habitually put the joys of heaven into the scale against the suffering of earth, and no solution of the problem of pain, which does not call into this the Christian one. You can't have a Christian solution to pain without talking about heaven. And so that's where we're at today. See, for a lot of us, we say, no, it's just what we believe and how we act, you know. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15, he says, listen, if all we have as Christians is this life, we are to be the most pitied people on the planet. Like, we have it rough. Because think about this. You are trying to go upstream. Have you ever been on a river and tried to row your boat, canoe, whatever, upstream? It's not exactly the easiest. And that's exactly what we're doing every single day. Every commercial that you practically watch, every television show that's on even the basic channels, they are all pushing you in the direction of sexual immorality and indulging in the flesh. And God is telling us, no, that's not it. You're missing it. I've given you all kinds of great things, but these are perversions of those good things. And so we're going against the current. And Paul's like, listen, if this is it and there is no resurrection, if this is it and there is no eternity with God the Father, Jesus Christ, if there is no eternity, if there is no reward, then we are to be pitied. Like this, we're crazy. Like this is not fun at all. And if there is no God, better yet, then who are you to say what is right and what is wrong? It's just your opinion. Doesn't really matter, does it? That is the difference between this. We have a built-in longing for heaven. In Ecclesiastes 3:11, it says that he has put eternity into man's heart. Tell me how many of y'all at times are just unsatisfied. How many of y'all at times your mind begins to wander? And I don't mean in the wrong direction. I just mean like there's got to be more. How many of y'all ever feel like maybe you're a fish out of water? You know, you just like there's something wrong with this. There's something wrong with my body. There's something wrong with my mind, the way that I'm thinking about things that I know I shouldn't be thinking about. There's something wrong that every time something happens to me, I'm getting sick or I'm always having these ailments or these problems. I mean, does anyone ever question? Do we ever question, like, why is this always? I mean, it just is a never-ending battle, a never-ending frustration. Has anyone ever said that? Because David says this in Psalms 16:11. This is kind of the verse of the entire message for today. It says, you have made known to me the path of life in your presence. Y'all listen to this. In your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. You see, in the presence of God, it is full satisfaction. It is full joy to the utmost. Like nothing you can possibly, in some sense or another, imagine here. Even the best situations that you've been in or gone to, places or people, are only a glimpse of what heaven will be like for all of eternity as we are on the new heaven, or in the new heaven and new earth. David even says this in Psalms 27:4. He says, one thing. I don't need a bunch of things. He says, one thing have I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Is that not good, church? He says, listen, this is the one thing. David was a rich man. Some of y'all say, if I can only have more money in my bank account, or if I can only have the job that gets me six figures or whatever else, I will be satisfied. And David had it. David was a very rich man. David was a very powerful man. David could have as many women as he wanted. He could have anything he wanted. And yet he says, the one thing that I want, the one thing that my heart beats for, the one thing that I long for, the one thing that I dream of, is to be in the presence of the Lord. To be in the presence of the Lord. And here's where a lot of us get off, and this will be the first point. We are longing, or we're dreaming and longing for the new heaven and the new earth. I was about to get ahead of myself. We are dreaming and longing for the new heavens and new earth. Have you ever heard the song? It was back in the 60s. Jim Reeves sang it, "This World Is Not My Home." Any takers out there that have ever heard, or maybe even a reference to, I'm sure he says in the first lines, he says, "This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore." You see, this world is not our home spiritually, but yet God says he's going to make a new heavens and new earth out of this old one. You see, God doesn't throw away, God redeems. That's where you can get some amens up in here, because God doesn't throw you away, God redeems you. God makes you into a new creation, not new as in new in time, but new in quality, new in essence. He says that the world is going to be burnt away. More or less, theologians say that's the exterior, all that is sin tainted, and we shall have this new world, this new heaven and new earth, in which righteousness and peace shall continually be the contemplation. Philippians 3:20 says this, "But our citizenship," where's it at? Is in church, heaven. "But our citizenship is in heaven." How many of y'all know, as a citizen, you begin to think about your home country? If you've ever been out of country, maybe you enjoyed it for a little bit of time, but there also comes that point in time where you're longing to go back home. You're longing for some familiarity. You're longing for the intimacy of the relationships in which you have. How many of y'all are longing for heaven because people that you know and that you love, who love Jesus, are already ahead of you in the great beyond? How many of y'all are simply saying that I want to be with the ones that I love first and foremost? I'm telling you, it's far greater. I know that a lot of y'all want to be with your loved ones, but the greatest loved one you'll ever have is King Jesus. The greatest one who will satisfy you is King Jesus. If you say, "I want heaven just so I can see a relative," you will not get heaven. But if you say, "I want heaven because I want Jesus," you will get Jesus and your relatives. For those who love the Lord, you shall see them. You shall be with them. Heaven is the answer to our problems. So I want to ask you a question. I want you, if you have your little pen, write this down. Not the question, but answering it. What is the new heavens and earth going to be like? Maybe it's one word. Because I know some of y'all are like, "I've thought about this a lot. I could be here all morning." Maybe not that, but what is the new heavens and new earth going to be like? Here's what I'd like to say, and this hopefully isn't you, but I'd like to say this. 2 years ago or more, it would have been more or less, I have some superficial answers, but I would be more of a deer with the headlights straight in my eyes, and I'm just like, don't really think about it. Don't really know. For a lot of us, we have a very bad view of heaven. If you listen to the secular world, they're like, heaven would be far worse than hell. At least in hell, I get to party with my friends. I want to tell you this, my friends. Hell is complete isolation from the very presence of God, which is where you find any sense of joy, happiness, peace. You will not be with friends in hell. You will be completely isolated from all that which is good. Because even those who say they hate God in this world still have the benefits of God. In hell, there are no benefits of God. Only eternal torment, weeping and gnashing of teeth, ultimate separation from God. Some people say that I love you so much, I don't want to tell you about sin. I'd much rather tell you about things that make you happy. I don't think that's love. Love is to tell someone that they're going in the wrong direction and the cliff is right over the next corner. Love is to actually care for someone enough. So what is the new heavens and earth going to be like? 1 Corinthians 2, 9 and 10 says this, but as it is written, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, what no mind has imagined. I mean, think about this real quick. He's over here like throwing some words at you. You've seen some stuff. How many of y'all have seen some beautiful pictures and you're like, man, if I can go there, if I can save my money, I'm going to go to that island, or I'm going to go on that type of hunt, or I'm going to go and dive off this cliff or whatever to some exotic place that's very remote in the world. Like, you've seen some amazing things. And what's he saying right here? No eye's seen. No ear. You've heard of some amazing things, haven't you? You've heard of some wonderful things out there, things that maybe used to be and that you don't know that they're available anymore to you. And here's the other thing, things that minds can't even imagine. When y'all watch scientific movies or sci-fi movies or whatever else, and you just see this crazy outer world, it's like, mind has not even imagined, what does it say? What God has prepared for those who love him. Verse 10, though, this is where people normally stop. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. Now, do we know all of these things? Absolutely not. Do we know exactly what they're going to look like? Absolutely not. The Old Testament prophets did not know what the Messiah was going to look like. It says they saw him from far away. See, the Jews at the time when Jesus came thought that the Messiah was going to be this warrior who was going to rip the Romans' heads off, and yet he came as a what? Lamb. Surrendered his life to ultimately destroy sin and destroy death through the death of the righteous. For so many of us, we have this endless, boring church service in your mind. That is what you think of heaven. There are so many people that think it's some extraterrestrial floating on clouds, and we have our harps that we're playing, and we have our white robes that never get stained. So can you have coffee there or not? You know, I mean, is that not something we can have? I mean, we have this idea that it is going to be so boring and so static. And so, I mean, think about it. Who wants to sing worship songs for 1,000 years? If we sing more than 4 worship songs, y'all get mad at us and say, oh my gosh, like I can't stand for this long. It's like, y'all walk through the mall for 5 hours straight and you're telling me I can't stand for more than 4 worship songs. If the preacher guy keeps on going too long, you're like, oh wow, man. I mean, I know I TiVo'd the game, but I can't get out. You know what I'm saying? Like, we have these like expectations of like, it's gotta be short. It's more than that. Oh, man, but I want to tell you some things that I initially read when I was younger in the faith. I was like, whoa, it's not going to be there. I want to read you a few verses just to give you an idea of what I'm talking about. For the first heaven and earth had passed away. Well, what about chili dogs? I mean, come on, who likes a chili or a pizza? A pizza, I mean, is it not going to be pizza? The old is gone and the new has come. But I didn't hear anything about chili dogs. I didn't hear anything about pizzas. What about NFL football? What about college football? Surely Bama won't be in heaven. 6 years running, it's the mark of the beast. Next year's our year. And there was no longer any sea. What? I've not even gotten to go deep water sea fishing. I want to go. And he says, there's no longer any sea. What about putting your feet, have you ever done this? Digging into the sand, just digging your feet into the sand, or David Hasselhoffing down the side of the beach, you know, just making a little roar, making a ripple. You got waves, God, I got my own, you know, kind of deal. Oh, it says there's no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming out from heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. The city, that's all there is the big city, a housing complex that's 16 stories high. Really? And you're like, I thought you were going to encourage us about heaven. I am. Give me a second. So all there is a city. I mean, I don't know about y'all. We live in small town USA, but when you go into Shreveport, which is still relatively small town USA, no one likes to go on Uri Drive in December. It's horrible. It's like a mini version of Dallas, Houston, Chicago, New York, wrapped in one with a bunch of people who don't really know how to drive. Listen, when you can go, you should go, okay? Just move on. Keep going. Is it going to be like that? What about the woods? What about hunting? I mean, seriously, Bubba's got to kill the hogs. Are hogs going to be in heaven? Are they going to be there? What about them big old trophy bucks? And there's no more need for sun or for the moon to shine in it. But I enjoy the sun, especially on a cold morning on my face and watching the fog roar up. And here's the answer to it all. pictures and symbols. So much more. So much grander. So much more beautiful. So much more satisfying. So much beyond what eye can see and ear can hear and your mind can even conceive. Paul even says in Ephesians chapter 3, he says, think about this. I'm praying for you to know the depth and the length and the breadth and the width of God's love. Like, you can't even begin to fathom how much he loves you. And if he's given us Jesus, how much more shall he give us? Man, I'm telling you, I'm excited whether you are. It's exciting. Think about this. Heaven is not going to be boring. Heaven is always going to be the aha. Think about this. You get bored almost every single day, and that's why you flip through the social media nonsense. It's nothing there. Or why you watch the TV shows that you, at the end of the day, you say, well, I wasted my time. You did, and I did. But the thing is like you're always looking for something more, and the something more is God. You're longing for what you cannot have here, and those longings are there for a reason to point you in the right direction. Too many times, we allow those longings to point us in all the wrong directions. Into a someone, or into a job, or into a bottle, or into a needle, or into a pill, or into something that pleases us temporarily, that never satisfies, and we always have to take more of it because we get numb to it, and God is not like that. Shoot, come on. Come on now. Randy Alcorn said this, our belief that heaven is boring betrays a heresy. We're lying about God. When our minds, when even that, it says that God is boring. There is no greater nonsense. Our desire for pleasure and experience of joy comes directly from God's hand. Listen to this. He made our taste buds, adrenaline, sex drive, and the never-ending desire to convey pleasure to our brains. Are we so arrogant as to imagine that human beings came up with the idea of having fun? Snap. Like, you thought, and I think, that we are the ones who can have fun. And some people, this is where some of y'all are at, and I'm not calling anybody out because I don't know, but some of us have the idea that heaven must be boring because everything is good and perfect there, because we have the idea perverted in our minds that that which is wicked must be fun. That is the perversion of this world, the God of this world. That is not God. God is the giver of all pleasure. It is we with our sinful intentions and minds who desire to twist that which is good and pervert that which is virtuous. Satan never came up with anything on his own. All he does is twist which God has given us freely. When you hear about the streets of gold in heaven, that does not mean that you need to get on all fours and see if it is 18 karat or 24 karat. It is symbolism, my friends. How many of y'all with a ring on your hand, male, female, does not matter, that has a gold ring, 12 karat, 18 karat, 24 karat, has a gold ring, and when you read those verses, and it says that the streets of gold are transparent like glass. Show me your ring and tell me you can see through it. Symbolism, metaphor for something so much greater than streets of gold. And if they're there, praise the Lord. But I just want to let you know it's bigger and it's better. And it's greater and grander than our minds, than our ears, than we can imagine. Y'all with me on this? Are you starting to get an idea about what heaven's about? It's more. Man, I've been longing for heaven for a while now. I'm just like, it's more than that. Think about this. When you think about walls that are 144 cubits high, don't think about 216 feet walls. They're clear. It says they're jasper. They're like glass. I mean, what is that going to protect you from? There's no wicked people there. There's not even really a need for that. Talking about the beauty and the transparency of our relationship with God. There's so much more. When you begin to think about no ocean, I want you to understand that all throughout the Old Testament, what was the ocean a picture of? What was it a picture of? One, the physical, only one instance, the physical was a separation of nations, separation from our fellow brothers and sisters. Okay, no separation whatsoever, perfect unity with our brothers and sisters in Christ, with our God. But the other part of all the Old Testament, the main consuming factor, the sea always had what? Evil. It always represented the evil of humanity. Where does the beast arise from in Revelation 13? From the sea. Read the book of Revelation. You're going to see again and again and again and again. Sea is a negative connotation for that which is evil. He's saying there is no more evil. So when you start worrying about, is God going to let us have a sea? Who knows what it'll be like? Who knows? Think about this. If God in a fallen world has given us so many beautiful things, and yet he said this is going to be a perfect world where he dwells perfectly with us, how much better that our poor little imaginations can't even fathom is it going to be? how much better is it going to be? What do we have to do? We have to look with our eyes of faith. Hebrews 11:1. What does it say? Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not yet seen. How many of y'all want to hang out and run and play ball and have just a really great time laughing and telling stories with some of those who have gone before you? Huh? How many of y'all want to do that and be there and experience? No, think about how many times, and this is always with me, how many times you have to code everything that you say to everyone else because you're worried how they're going to take it, what mood that they're in, and what happened to them early in the day, and are they going to bite your head off? How many of us worry about that? But yet in heaven, there is perfect love, perfect transparency, perfect truth. And so you don't have to waste 3/4 of your day coding what you say. I mean, you know, me, I'm excited about that. Got to code everything you say. You're the preacher. It's either good or you're horrible. You know, it's like one of the two. You're never in the gray. What about hanging out with Adam and Eve and maybe like asking him, like, what were you thinking, man? You know, what about Abraham and Moses and Joshua? And Daniel and Esther and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Paul. And what about Jesus? What about Jesus? See, a lot of us think in time. And in time, time is another way to say death, to be very honest with you. Time separates us. And when it keeps on ticking, sooner or later, your time ends. In heaven, there is moment by moment, but there is never a loss of actuality. It's beyond my little brain. But God is outside of time, therefore he's creating all of eternity that would have successive moments, but yet we're never missing anything, always enjoying everything, perfect fellowship. I know my dad. I never met my dad's dad, Frank Burford. Now, I can't imagine that he's going to want to have a wonderful time, this warm embrace, this hug that's greater than a bear hug, you know? I mean, just one of those huge embraces. Or my mom with her dad, or my mom with her sister, and whoever else. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's going to be warmth and embrace to forever. And think, I want you to think about this. Some of y'all would say that God took someone too soon, or they died too soon, but yet you are going to have all of eternity to fulfill that relationship of that which you felt was too short. I mean, y'all start thinking about this stuff. Our God is a good God, and he's going to allow us all of eternity, not in the clouds. He's creating a new earth, one far better than this one if you love this one, far better than this one. In John chapter 14, verse 1 and 2, Jesus says this because they're all worried. He says, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. And what does he say? I go to prepare a place for you. Now, whether you take it literally or metaphorically, how long did it take God to make heaven and earth? Right? 6 days. And then he rested. A lot of symbolism in there, but nonetheless, 6 days. Jesus has been gone for almost 2,000 years. I go to prepare a place for you. I've heard one person once say that when we get to heaven, it's going to feel very much so as though God made it just for us. Perfectly satisfied, perfectly meeting every single longing in our lives here on earth. He's preparing a place for us. Number two is this, death and pain shall be no more. Revelation 21, verse 1, I just want to read this to you. It's so good. There's so much there when you read it. It says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out from heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more. For the former things, praise the Lord, have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give them from the springs of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, As for the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and all the liars, their portion will be in the lake of fire that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Death, listen to this, death and pain shall be no more. Done. Over. Finito. It's over with. God is preparing us for the perfect habitation which you have and I have longed for all of our lives. What does it say in verse 3? Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell with them. What's John 1:14 say about Jesus? And the Word became flesh and dwelt among them. God has visited us. God has sacrificed for us. And on that cross, what did he say? It is finished. It is finished. Now, are people still dying right now as we're waiting for the coming of Jesus? Absolutely. But the power of sin and of death is defeated at the cross of Jesus Christ. For those who believe in him, the second death has no power over their lives. Come on now. That's where it's at. It's not just physical death Jesus tells us to fear. It's the second death that he tells us to fear, where it says that God kills both body and soul. I mean, think about this. Not annihilation, but destroys all that which is good. He says in verse 4, he'll wipe away every tear. How many of y'all have cried a few nights in your life? A few days maybe, a few months maybe, a few years possibly. He says every single one of those tears, I'm going to wipe them away. And I want you to think about it. You're like, why would I be crying? He's saying, I'm taking away all of the past burden of pain, and you are going to be finally comforted. Unlike you've ever been comforted before, satisfied, unlike you've ever been satisfied before. He says, finally, what? He's going to wipe away every tear, and death shall be no more. There's no more funerals. No more funerals. They're out of business. No more me having to preach awkward messages about people I really haven't gotten to know at funerals. Like, no more. Like, that's done. Death is over with. There's no more of that. No more car accidents. No more cancer. No more short lives. None of that. No more mourning, no crying or pain, nothing but joyful exultation in heaven because of what? The former things are gone. Genesis chapter 3, 4, it's done. It's done. It is finished. And he echoes the word that Jesus said on the cross when he says, it is done. It's finished. I've finished it. He says, now listen to what he says. I am the Alpha and the Omega. I'm the beginning and the end. Do you understand what God's over here saying? He's like, I started it. I'll end it. I write history, I finish history. I'm sovereign over all of the beginning and the end. And what does he also mean when he says I'm the beginning and the end? He says I am sovereign over all that's in the middle of it too. I cannot help but express to encourage y'all to believe in the power and the sovereignty of God according to the word of God. Like, you've just got to begin to soak that in because there is so much comfort to be had there. He says to the one who conquers, he will have a heritage. What is the heritage? He is going to inherit God himself, Christ himself. We shall be one with them as he has called for us to be one. Praise, man, I'm excited. The third point is this. We'll keep rolling. Our glorious resurrected bodies await us. Our glorious resurrected bodies, they await us. What would you like to do in the new heavens and new earth? What would you like to do? Have you thought about this? And you're like, well, what if everything's different? Who cares? What would you like to do? How many of y'all can physically climb Mount Everest right now? Probably none of us. I mean, probably none of us. But, I mean, how cool would that be to be on the very peak of the tallest mountain, the tallest place in the world? I mean, how many of y'all would like to run the Boston Marathon? Not me. But I'm just saying, to have the ability to do that and to not grow weary, to not grow tired. God is giving us new and resurrected bodies, giving us new minds that no longer contemplate sin and temptation to it. God is giving us power. I cannot help but think that God is providing for us graciously. Think about this. He says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 35, that second place I told you to turn. He says, but someone will ask, how are the dead raised? What kind of body do they have, or will they become? Paul says, you foolish person. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow in the body, that is to be, but is a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God has given it a body, as he has chosen, each to its own kind of seed is his own body. For not all flesh is the same, but there is one kind for humans and another kind for animals and another kind for birds and another kind for fish. There's heavenly bodies and there's earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly one is of one kind and the glory of the earthly one is of another kind. The glory, one glory for the sun and another glory for the moon and another glory for the stars, and all the stars differ from the other stars. Listen to what he says in verse 42. It's on the screen. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. What is he over here saying? How many of y'all, every time that you grab an acorn off the ground, realize that it has the capacity and the potential to be one great oak tree 100 years or 200 years from now? God's over here saying, if we actually knew what he has in store for us in these broken bodies with these broken minds and all these longings and desires that cannot be fulfilled here, he's saying, you just don't know. You're more than an oak tree. The potential when God unlocks it is absolutely unlimited as he puts us in the perfect place in which we were created for. We have new bodies coming our way. How many of y'all are excited about that? We will absolutely know our true identity within those bodies. For it says in Revelation 2:17, to the one who conquers, I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone. And what's the big deal about the white stone? With a new name written on the stone so that no one knows except the one who it is given to. Your name identifies who you are, and God is saying, you get a new name, and it's between me and you, and it identifies who you are. And some of y'all are like, I don't want a new name. I like my name. Listen. If God's giving you the new name, it's going to be better, okay? Some of y'all are so stubborn. And you're like, but I didn't say anything. You thought it, okay? You did think, you're like, but I like my name. You know, seriously, if God's giving you the name, it's going to be good. If God's planning it for us, it's going to be great. If God is creating it for us, it's going to blow your mind. It's going to be awesome. And you say, Josh, how are you so sure about these things? I trust God. What do you mean? Jesus died on the cross for me. I mean, what do you mean? Like, I don't understand you. If you don't understand me, I don't understand that. I trust him. I really do. He's a good God. And when he does good things, sometimes that's scary because a good dentist will go all the way to the very bottom of the root and it might hurt horribly bad. But nonetheless, he's a good dentist. Our God's a good God. And when we use the word goodness, sometimes we need to be careful as exactly what does that mean, because our culture has defined things different than God has. Our God is a God of love. He loved us so much that he murdered his son on our behalf. Just remember that a God of love is not the exact same kind of love that some of us show, which is not love at all, where we say, you know what, I'll do anything just to make you happy or just to shut you up. That's not love. It's not love at all. That's hurting someone else. It's not love at all. So he says this, George MacDonald quoting kind of off of that verse. He says, God's name for a man must be the expression of his own idea of the man or the woman, that being whom he had in his thought when he began to make the child, and whom he kept in his thought through the long process of creation, which went to realize the idea. To tell the name is to seal the success. Do y'all understand what God's over here doing? He is giving you a new name because he has a purpose for you that is being worked out all the way through your life here on earth and is sealing it in eternity according to what he has called you and created you to do. The second thing is this, we'll have perfected hearts. How many are excited about not wanting to sin anymore? I mean, are any of y'all get hyped up about that? Any of y'all kind of sick of you and you're stuck in your body? I mean, does any of you get tired of the stuff that you think about or the things that get triggered in your mind when something happens around you or when a commercial comes around you or anything? I mean, are y'all like tired of it? There should be way more. Way more. I don't like me a lot of the time. I'm sick of the wickedness. I'm sick of the thoughts and the wondering, and I'm tired of those things. And I want to tell you this, too. For those of you who say, you know what, I really don't care about that stuff, I'll tell you this. The closer you get to Jesus, this is a fact, closer you get to Jesus, the more aware of your sinful nature you will be. For some of you who say, you know what, I just feel like I get everything's good in my world. I don't really ever have a problem. I want to say that is how far you are from your relationship and closeness with God when you think that ain't nothing going on there. Just because you're not cutting someone's throat with a knife, you lunatic, does not mean that you're not sinning with your thoughts. and with your ideas and with your hands. Just because you're not acting out on it does not mean it's not there. So for some of us who are just like, you know what, I don't feel anything bad about my life, I'll go ahead and tell you there's some repenting that needs to happen just right now. Just go ahead. You don't have to like fall on the ground or anything, but just right now, just start asking. Paul says this in Romans 7:24, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? But thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. There will be no longer, am I going to have another God ahead of you, God? No, I'll be perfectly one with God. There'll no longer be, will I lie, because the father of lies will be destroyed in the burning pit of sulfur and fire. No longer will I lust after another woman. I mean, no longer will any of those things take place. None of those will be gone because there will be perfect unity between us and love for one another. No longer, hey, there's a lot of us who are so eaten up with bitterness because we're jealous of other people and what they have in their lives and what God has given them. No longer it will be wiped away and we will be excited for wherever God so chooses to put people. Because for some of y'all, if y'all are still thinking that you're going to be hanging out on clouds, no, God has created a new earth for us to rule and to reign with him. It says the kings of the earth will bring their glory into the great and mighty city of God. The very presence of the city itself is absolutely a description of the old temple, but 250,000 times bigger and better. I mean, y'all, you guys, it's good. Symbolism is there. Take it further. God hasn't called us to have minds like child. God called us to receive the kingdom of heaven like a child. But our minds are to be sharp. Our minds are to be continually grown and to be continually renewed. And we're to push ourselves. And we're not to be satisfied with being ignorant. Don't let us be. Paul said, don't do that. I can't wait. Think about this. We will have new minds as well. Not just new bodies and a new heart, but we'll have new minds. What about those who are mentally handicapped? Come on. Autism. Come on, my Uncle Steve, he's 62 years old. He has the mindset of about a six-year-old. Oh, I can't wait. He's going to run. Not going to grow weary. He's going to think clear. Clearer than he's ever thought before. Clearer than we've ever thought before. You don't know what God has in store for those in which you thought here on earth were a little bit of nobodies. You also don't know what, for some of you who God has gifted in the ability of leadership and other things, and you did it in a haughty and arrogant manner, no matter what other people thought about you, but God knew your heart, how God will use you in a different manner in capacity. There is no bad gifts. Don't get me wrong in heaven. Heaven's going to be wonderful. I'm just simply saying that as it is now, we are not to judge, but wait until the day of the Lord himself. Down syndrome, autistic, mentally handicapped, they're going to have beautiful minds for those who love God. Beautiful minds for those who love God. It says in 1 Corinthians 13:12, it says, for now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we're going to see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. 1 John 3:2 says this, when he appears, we shall be like him because we shall see him as he is. Now think about it. These verses are not just to get you going. These verses are literally to make you start thinking. You want a discipline in your life? It's not the new diet or the new fad. The discipline in your life should be trying to find ways every single day, whether you're driving down the road, whether you're cutting grass, whether you're at work, contemplating, meditating upon heaven. And just beginning, like, I just want to start setting some dates. We're going to climb Mount Everest. You know, I mean, just start putting some stuff down. I don't know what your thing is. Just start putting it down. Is it going to be like that? I don't know. Won't hurt to dream. How about some of y'all? Do y'all love the stars? Any of y'all out there just look on a clear night and just begin to just say, oh, man, look at all those stars. Look at how beautiful it is. How many of y'all would like to go visit other galaxies? You're going to live forever. No more pain. Your mind's going to be perfect. We'll always be learning. We'll always be growing. But perfect mind. Who's to say we don't go visit all the, you know, we spend all of our energy and resources just trying to go to Mars. No, we ain't going to do nothing there, but you know what I'm saying? Like, what about new heaven, new earth, and the capacity to have unlimited ability? Y'all seen that goofy movie called, maybe, was it Limitless or something like that? Basically, he can think really fast and all that. Way better. And pure. That's not pure. Pure. Last one is this, we close. God will eternally dwell with his people. This is the big one. And you're like, but Yeah, I know that's a Christian answer, is to say that's the big one. Nope, it's the big one. It's the big one. There is no heaven where there is no Jesus. You could be in hell, but with Jesus, it would be heaven. There is no heaven without Jesus. Revelation 22:4 says this, they will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. I want you to think about this for a minute. Perfect, just perfect knowledge of God, perfect intimacy with God, a perfect relationship, no shame, no need to repent anymore. The former things are gone. I don't even, listen, because true freedom in God is not the desire to sin, but the desire to do which is obedient to God. You're not going to be sinning. You're not even going to want to do it. We will laugh about the Ten Commandments. Honestly, in heaven, it'll be brought up as a joke simply because we don't do it. You won't have to tell your neighbor to know God. Everybody will. No locked doors. No hunger. No thirst. None of it. I'm just saying, I know I'm not doing a great job, but this is just like to whet your palate, to get you excited, to know that you're living for something more. And if you're going through hell right now, I want you to know as a Christian, heaven awaits you. If you're going through hell right now, heaven awaits those who love God. Love God. There's not a greater message in the world than the gospel. There is no other religion that has any message like we have. Not a single one. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. He says he will put his name on our forehead. Again, what does that mean? It's Old Testament referencing. What's the Old Testament reference? It says that the high priest had holy to God. Our holiness to God. Every single one of us are high priest to God. Offering perfect sacrifice to God. On an earth. That's insane. When you think about the Garden of Eden, just blow it up way bigger. The entire earth. Again, keep going. I'm just saying, keep going. Keep pressing. Keep pushing. No matter what you're going through, this is the other side of that coin. 6 weeks to go through. Let's walk through it. Let's cry through it. Let's hurt through it. Just one day, and not nearly enough justice to it, but one day just to remind you, because of where we're going, you can keep on. Because of where, you can suffer unlike anyone has ever suffered, and you can keep on going because you know where you're going. Because you have hope. That is the breath that we breathe, is hope in eternity. I pray that you just begin to dream, if nothing else from this message. If you have never called upon the name of Jesus, don't be a fool. Do that. Ask God. Ask Jesus to forgive you of your sin. Oh, stand. Let's stand. Let's pray.